tersebut yang membohongan. Datuk Petinggi Tan Sri Dr. Haji Anwar Cisatin, Ketua Menteri Sarawak, untuk menyampaikan ucapan penggulungan.
Terima kasih Yang Dipertua, yang beri saya peluang untuk sebanyak menguraikan dasar kerajaan, apa yang kerajaan telah buat dalam masa 4 bulan ini dan sebagainya. Tapi sebelum itu, saya ingin membangkit 2-3 perkara kepada Tuan-Tuan Limit Rumah. Which concerns me personally. Number one, when you succeed someone who was chief minister for 33 years, more than a generation, you sometimes don't believe that you actually am. I remember an occasion, just a few months after my appointment as chief minister. You know, in all the 30 years, when you say CM, you know who it refers to. It refers to our PHC, the present PYP. So nearly more than one generation are used to saying CM has been PHC. So in the first few months, I cannot get used to the idea that I am CM. Because every time everybody mentions CM, I say, where is he? There was one occasion and one function when I think I was with the state secretary. I'm waiting for our TYT to come. So while waiting at the entrance, I asked the state secretary, when is CM coming? And the guy said, the state secretary said, with a smile, hey, don't you know you are CM? But after 14 months, I'm less confused. Now I am well and truly the Chief Minister of Sarawak. Number two, you know, it gets very tedious, very boring. Every time you have a function or some do, you are called Yang Amat Dohomar Datuk Fatinggi Datuk Amat Dr. Haji Adnan bin Saddam. Just call me CM cukup lah. And after to that, the next speaker will also repeat the same thing. The next speaker will repeat the same thing. So please, protocol might not be happy with this one, but just call me CM, that will do. Or even better still, just call me Adnan. That was the name given by my mother. And number three, perhaps in reference to the gentleman next to me, please don't call me beloved Chief Minister. That is reserved for my wife, my children, and my grandchildren.
By your wife, your children, and the people of Sarawak.
Yeah. So, I feel very embarrassed. Very embarrassed before coming. That's reserved, I say, for my wife, my children, and my grandchildren. And occasions like my birthday or my first anniversary as chief minister, don't put too many congratulatory advertisements in the newspapers. Please, you better spend that money to give to charity. That I would have to. That is my preliminary objection. So I come to the substance of what I have to say today. Generally, in relation to the state economy, economic development is fundamental to the prosperity of any country. All these years, government has put a lot of effort to develop our economy to be where we are today. In the case of Sarawak, economy has developed and expanded. As a result, we now know have a strong economy and is the third largest in the country after Strano and Kuala Lumpur. The journey that we have taken over the years has resulted in our economy having good credit rating. I think we got a triple A rating that remains positive and stable outlook from credible rating agencies. So we have a certain amount of financial credibility that is for a rated 3A. We have worked hard to transform our economy from agriculture-based to an economy which is based on manufacturing and services. This is clearly reflected whereby in 2014, the manufacturing and services sector had significantly contributed 64% to the state economy. That figure is still very small and poor. But because of the shifting of our economy from agriculture to commercial and industrial base, they account for 60%. And I think the number in percentage is growing. These achievements were made possible due to our far-sighted development philosophy, policies and development plans that we have formulated and implemented all these many years. We are determined to do more in the future, accelerate our economic growth and development to benefit Rakyat. The best option for us, therefore, is to formulate our development strategy that will broaden our economic base by introducing more high-value activities in all sectors of our economy. Downstream activities add that value. Industrialization is the way forward for Sarawak. We will attract more high-tech industries to invest in the state. And meanwhile, for existing industries, there is also a need for these industries to deepen their industrial base for moving up the value chain, thus creating more value-added activities. Our primary objective in developing our economy is ensure that we will continue to create enough business and employment opportunities to the Rakyat. Industrialization of the state and the creation of more value-added activities in all sectors of the economy will therefore help us achieve this objective. With regard to the rural economy, a good and conducive business climate and investment environment is paramount for the private sector to decide on their choice of investment location. Therefore, it is only logical that when we first started to industrialize, most of the industrial activities were concentrated in urban areas with better infrastructure and facilities needed by industry. We would like to see these industries and businesses develop and expand, including to the rural areas. We will, of course, continue to develop more industrial infrastructure in the urban and suburban areas to support greater industrial development in the future. While industrialization is working well in the urban areas, we need to adopt a different strategy to develop the rural economy, as these areas are still lagging behind in basic infrastructure that are the prerequisite for business activities. The right strategies need to be put in place to tap a huge economic potential in the rural areas. Among the huge potential in the rural areas that we put in, 10 are the fields of agriculture, ecotourism, forest plantation, and agriculture. To unlock this potential. The state government has completed a socio-economic master plan that will chart out the development strategies and action plan to be undertaken commencing the 11th Malaysia Plan. In this master plan, several growth nodes have been identified as the focus areas with government spending the necessary enablers and the private sector to invest as the engine of growth. Despite these challenges, the government is adamant in developing our rural economy as a large portion of our population are residing in rural areas, and rural folk also deserve a good quality of life comparable to urban areas. A well-organized rural economy is important to support the development of Sarawak. In the medium term, rural areas will be the primary producers of agriculture produce, livestock, aquaculture, many food items to meet our domestic market. In the long run, we believe that large-scale production through better farm mechanization, application of modern technology, improvement in the productivity of farmers, and a wider marketing network will enable our rural economy to be transformed as a major agricultural producer in this region to meet global demand. The domestic market is comparatively small. We have to develop an international market. We have to find export outlets for our agricultural products and so on. The domestic market alone cannot sustain this development. Rural communities are expected to benefit from a transformed rural economy. However, it is important for them to become active participants in this respect. They must get themselves organized and equipped with the right knowledge and skills to become successful entrepreneurs, especially in the access areas of ecotourism, homestay and agriculture. At the same time, through more business and job creation by the private sector in the rural areas, we should be able to see further reduction in the incidence of poverty in the state. If you want to find where the poor people are, go to the rural areas. If you want to find where the rich people are, go to the towns. Basically, that is the demand. At the same time, to promote business and job creation by the private sector in the rural areas, we should be able to see further reduction in incidence of poverty in the state. This initiative will also address the issue of rural-urban migration. This effort must be read in the context of rural-urban migration. Why do rural people migrate to the towns and cities? Because there are more economic opportunities to be found in cities. And there is not much to wait for in the rural area. That is the area we must uplift. So in this context of trying to stem the tide of rural-urban, we must therefore develop. You cannot blame people if they prefer to live in the town, because the facilities are there, the opportunities are there. Ask them to wait at the kampung, what is there for them to wait? So that is one area which we have to deal with so that there will be less of this social disequilibrium. We have seen the success of integrating rural and urban economies in developed countries, and we would like to see similar success to happen as well. A well-developed rural economy will also help to address socio-economic imbalances between these areas. We will be able to enjoy better income and higher quality of life.